And then in 1996, you went abroad for the first time.
In between, there were some other talks. So 1995 is the Quran God's word. So first, there were a few hundred, then became a few thousand. And I gave the talk in Birla Mathushri. In 1995 is the Quran God's word. There were a few thousand people, though the capacity is only 1,200. But there were a few thousand people who turned up, and there was a big chaos there.
And there usually is at your talks. There usually is where you were concerned. All right, now, so that's how you started off.
That's
and
right.
Then you used to appear on various television channels and other things, and then you started your own TV channel called Peace TV. So how is Peace TV doing now?
Yes, alhamdulillah. Peace TV, I say that it's a channel of the people. I don't say it belongs to me. Fine, you can call me as a brand ambassador. You know, as you say that Shah Rukh Khan is the brand ambassador for Tiger. So if you call me a brand ambassador, it's a better statement. Or a fine, I'm an advisor, and that's it. So as far as Peace TV is concerned, as you may be aware, it was first started in January 2006. That is the Peace TV main channel, which had about 75% English, 25% Urdu, Hindi mixed. And it kept on spreading. It was on one satellite, then two, then three, then four, then five, six. It was throughout the world. By the time, in the span of 1.5 years after it started, it was spread throughout the world. Anyone puts a dish, any part of the world, whether it be America, Europe, any part of the world, you could see it. Last year, in 2009, in June, one more channel was launched, Peace TV Urdu. From the main channel, all the Urdu Hindi program were removed. It became 100% English channel. And then we had a new channel, Peace TV Urdu, last year. And inshallah, we have hopes in December to launch a third channel, Peace TV Bangla.
Wonderful, absolutely wonderful. All right, now, let's come back to your case, as far as the UK case is concerned. Two things. A, perhaps they have been misinformed or whatever, but
I doubt.
Do they usually do that? They don't usually do that, because you've been to UK before.
They don't.
Because they're very thorough in what they do.
Is a new government. So I feel they took a decision in haste. As you know, I've been to UK several times, and they talk about freedom of expression. I never had any problem. In fact, the last visit, I was standing in the queue in the Heathrow airport. Right at the end of the queue, an officer called me. I said, okay, fine. Do you want to question me? He said, Dr. Naik, you know, we see you on the TV, and they got me in the front. Imagine. So there are many people in the immigration who know me. So this, I believe, because it's a new government, hardly been in power for 1.5 months. And this conservative government, as you may be aware, initially was in the opposition.
Yes.
Used to always tell the government in power that because of you, you're allowing people to speak and you get them inside. That is the reason all this terrorism is there. Now, when they came to power, it was, as you said, many groups are working against me. There was an article that came in Sunday Times on 30th of May.
Yes.
2010. The person who wrote the article was David Lippard. And he wrote this, that a preacher of hate is let into Britain, saying how come this new government, conservative government, is allowing people to preach such hate, etc. So there was a pressure on the new government that now you're in power, now you have to ban Dr. Zakir Naik. You have to exclude him from the country. And they give reasons, and they quote me out of context, whichever. So that's how I feel. It was more of a political decision rather than a legal decision. Because no legal person in his sound mind will ever take such a decision. So that's the reason, though, in the newspapers, the quotation was only half a sentence, saying Dr. Zakir Naik says, every Muslim should be a terrorist, which now it is clarified. But in the letter that Theresa May gave me, the full context is given. So after reading the full context, how could a person yet agree with the exclusion order?
And yet they did.
They did because, see, when you're in politics, you take a choice. They know both ways they're losing. So they take the choice in which they feel that they can maintain their seat. So if they exclude me, they can say, okay, we have kept our word, irrespective of what happens later on. And they know very well. And they were informed that if they exclude me, we will be going to the court.
लेकिन यहाँ पे डॉक्टर नायक, मैं जान करके ये सवाल इसलिए पूछ रहा हूँ, वाई वी आर कैरिंग आउट दिस एंटायर कैंपेन एज फार एज द आरकेबी शो इज कंसर्न्ड, लेट मी मेक इट वेरी क्लियर. यहाँ पर कुड दिस बी द बिगिनिंग ऑफ अ ट्रेंड इन द सेंस दैट यूके डज इट फर्स्ट, देन मे बी फ्रांस डज इट, देन जर्मनी डज इट, देन द रेस्ट ऑफ द यूरोपियन यूनियन फॉलोज सूट, एंड देन द यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स डू इट.
इट्स ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड.
राइट.
इमीडिएटली आफ्टर दैट we got a call from the Canadian
Canadian High Commission. Yes.
A call.
Yes.
Not an official letter. An official exclusion, they require everything to be passed. So just a call saying that you have a valid visa for 5 years of Canada, which was given to you last year, but we're sorry the visa is cancelled. However, if you want to travel again, you can apply. What does it mean? you have a validity of 5 years which was given to me last year. That's a Canadian
visa. That's right.
I applied for a normal visa, they gave me a worker's visa. Now, why will they give me a worker's visa when I ask for a normal visa? That means they had faith that this person is excellent. He has been to Canada before. First, they gave me 6 months visa. Then they gave me 2 years visa. Same in UK, same in Canada. So this thing has just started recently. And it will follow suit. And we are aware of that. Not only with me. Very shortly, because you know, after me, they are trying to exclude the other people also who are doing the same thing throughout the world.
So how do we combat this? In your opinion?
I feel that we should not use the dirty tricks what they are using. I will not quote anyone out of context. I will believe in fighting in a truthful way. Fighting is the wrong word to use now. It's dangerous. I would say challenge them. But if I say I'm fighting the UK government, it will come a headline, you know, Zakir fighting UK government again on YouTube. You know, so again they'll be after me. The right word, you know, so now I have to be careful of what word to use. It should be, I would like to challenge them or, right. You know, a request for a revision. And I feel today I have more faith in the judiciary system, rather than the political system. Whether it be judiciary system of India, I have more faith in it than the political system. And also I have more faith in the judiciary system of UK than the political system. But there are times when the politicians are very much endangered for their seat. They can go to the extent of even putting so much pressure on the judiciary system that they cannot take a just view. Or they cannot give a just verdict.
Which is sad, isn't it? Which is really sad.
Which is sad.
And that, by the way, just doesn't apply to you. It applies in lots of other things as well.
That's right.
Dr. Naik, a personal question to you. What about your own faith? What about your own... do you really believe in what you preach?
Of course. If I wouldn't have believed in what I preach, then I would have preached it. Because this, no one is paying me for that. It is absolutely honorary. It's absolutely complimentary. It's for my own in-depth pleasure, unlike many people. You know, as you know that I'm a medical doctor, but I'm just a silent partner in the medical profession.
When did you first to come to what the excerpt that we showed just now? You and Sri Sri Ravi Shankar together, and you were talking about a prophecy regarding the prophet in various Hindu scriptures. When did you first come across
that prophecy?
That's right. And did somebody point it out to you? Did you discover it by yourself? And then you studied the other three Vedas. You must have maybe read the Rig Veda first, because that's where everybody usually starts.
Yes, and that's the most authentic among all.
That's right. And because it's the oldest and it is the one which has the least number of interpolations. So,
as far as when did I read it the first time, I cannot tell you the exact date.
Yes.
Maybe somewhere in the late 80s or the early 90s, the first time. But whenever I get any reference, I always have a habit of verifying it. And I tell the other people also, even if you hear anything in my speech, just don't take it at face value. Go home and check it up, whether it's there in the Quran or the Veda or the Bible, so that you can say that you have checked it up directly, so you can remove the link of Zakir Naik out of it. But the more the links are there, the more unauthentic it becomes. So when I did read certain books mentioning the prophecies, I did do research and I found out that certain prophecies mentioned were too much exaggerated. So those which are exaggerated, I deleted, and those which were authentic and did suit a person's human logic, I started quoting. I did more research, I found more.
But isn't it amazing? How could, say something which was, as you yourself have mentioned, how could something say which has been written about Arya Dharma or Aryavarta, which is not even an organized religion at that time, it still is not organized, which is not even a religion at that time. How could something like that be extant in those holy books?
See, there are some people, you can have two versions of it. First, I'll give the version being a devil's advocate.
Right,
good. You know, some people say, you know, some of the Hindus say, oh, see, this thing was written by the Muslims. And it came in the holy scriptures. I said, fine, if I agree with you for sake of argument, that means your scripture is interpolated.
Right.
Which I'm not saying that. If yes. I agree, some. So you leave the scripture aside and take a scripture which is 100% pure. So that completely closes the argument. But what I feel that as Almighty God, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Ra'd, chapter number 13, verse number 38, that we have sent a revelation in every age. In every age, a revelation has been sent to the world. By name, only four are mentioned in the Quran: Torah, Zabur, Injil.